Hello, everyone. We're live with Joanna Wiebe.
Hola. Hello.
Hi.
Hi, sorry for that delay. I had Chromecast issues. Crowdcast. Crowdcast.
Chromecast
and
something
other things,
else.
Yeah. And the issue was on Chrome. So it's like Chrome.
Right.
Anyway, yeah. Right? Aries like Aries like who doesn't, right? Yeah. Issues. Tech. The promise of tech never actually realized. Thank you. People I know, I just got it done. What we think? I'm gonna get it colored tomorrow or today. Yeah, today. What day is it? Thank you. Cut it all off.
I don't do you need like a, okay, I'm gonna say that Joanna is the best conversion copywriter ever. I follow her. I've been following her for so many years, and everything she says, I'm like, oh, amen, great, just copy, ship it over. She's amazing. And you're going to teach us copy. So I'm just gonna let you do that, do your thing.
All right.
And I will just moderate questions towards the end. If you have any questions, post them in the chat box. And I'll just let you do your thing. I'm gonna turn off cameras though, right?
Yeah, that's fine, baby. That's good. Okay, my necklace, Dan, says love always, Dad, and it's written in my dad's actual handwriting. Very cool. Done on Etsy by my sister. Very good gift, I have to say. So if you don't know what to get someone for a gift, there you go. You're welcome. That's what this, actually, we're just gonna talk about stuff like that the next 37 minutes. No, I'm kidding. Obviously kidding. We're going to instead talk about my cat who I walk. No, we're not going to talk about that either, although I could fill a lot of time with that. We're not going to talk about Airstory's product roadmap. We're going to open the right keynote file. Yay. Here we go. Here we go. All right. Okay. You should be seeing my screen. I can no longer see any questions or chat, sadly, but Talia will tell me if you can't see my screen.
We can see everything and the awesome GIF or JIF, depending on who you are in the world, and if you're weird, GIF.
Right? Can we just solve that now? It's GIF.
GIF.
Stop saying JIF. I don't care if the guy who invented it calls it a JIF.
Okay, great.
Anyway, all right, we're moving forward. Okay, cool. So thank you for wading through those delays. This little GIF is your is my thank you gift to you. You're welcome. Zach Galifianakis with tiny hands and ponytails, like, or pigtails, like, what could be wrong? That's a way to get you excited for what we're going to talk about, which is conversion copywriting. Yay! Okay, no, so conversion copywriting is a very cool thing. It is the work that happens on the page. So some people are like, oh man, oh, can someone else please write my copy for me? And sometimes that's a really good idea, but a lot of times we're going to find ourselves writing our own copy. And so that's why if you're interested in growth, you're interested in CRO, you're optimizing your funnel, you're writing video scripts, anything you might be doing to market and grow your business, to retain customers, to get referrals, just sharing on social media, that all comes down to the words that you use. So we're going to talk about how to get a lot sharper with the decisions that you make around the words that you use when you're writing copy. Now, the problem with writing copy, the biggest problem, the one I keep seeing year after year, business after business, is that copywriting is writing. So that's a problem because writing is just this thing that we all do. There's a sense of like, well, once you have learned how to write your name, once you've learned cursive, which I understand they no longer teach in school, crazy anyway, but once you've got literacy down, now you can write. And so we tend to look at copywriting as just a form of writing, which means all the rules, which are very soft rules that we have for writing, or that we think are soft at least, those rules all apply. So when it's time for you to write a landing page or write that sales email sequence or whatever it is that you might be writing to grow your business, you do the things that you believe you're supposed to do when you're quote unquote writing. So that might mean you go off to a quiet place to write. Okay, you go to this nice quiet room, you put on your headphones maybe, everything is like, ooh, we're gonna get quiet, we're gonna get library quiet here, like quiet place to write. Because in order to write well, of course, You have to be alone with your thoughts. How are you going to succeed at writing, the act of writing, this romantic act, if you're not alone with your thoughts? Yet somehow, when you are writing, when you are sitting there trying to write in this quiet space with the fire going, somehow genius simply doesn't strike. It's almost like it doesn't work like that. It's like, that's not how writing really happens. So genius doesn't strike when you're off by your own. Turns out that the copy you've been writing sucks. Like, the copy that's sitting in your head sucks. Like, if I knew everybody was cool with swearing, there would have been a lot of F-bombs preceding sucks, because it sucks. So what do? You give up. You give up on writing entirely. You go find something / anything else to do. That's the typical writing process, made real in The Shining, which hopefully you're all familiar with, or else you're like, what are these weird gifts doing? That's what we think writing is, and that's not what copywriting is. That's creative writing, and sometimes that's even creative copywriting, and it has absolutely no place in business. Your growth strategy cannot depend on you going off and waiting for the muse to strike you in a quiet room. That is like trying to win the lottery. I'm just gonna go sit somewhere and hope that the lottery wins me somehow. I don't know how that would even work, but that's the idea, right? This sense that writing is this romantic act, even when it's there for business, it's this act where it's between you and the page. You look at the page, you put your ideas on the page, you conquer that page. And the more drunk you are, the better the likelihood that you'll actually succeed at it, right? So there are these myths and these legends about, you know, Hemingway, and you have to be crazy drunk in order to come up with a great ad campaign or something like that. That is all untrue. And it's this myth, like most myths, that conspiracy theory alert, it's like built to make you not successful. So the more you believe that you have to wait for some genius to strike you, or that you can manufacture that genius by having a drink or going off to a quiet room or whatever thing you think, it's like when baseball players keep wearing dirty socks or something during like the winning season, these crazy superstitions you have about what actually makes great writing happen. It's none of that at all. Writing is a structured thing with real rules. Rules that if you follow them and build on them, your writing gets better. If you ignore them, your writing is crap, period. It's the crap that comes out when you weren't actually giving writing, and copywriting in particular, the respect it deserves. So writing does have the structure built in. I could tell you that, and you'd be like, really, what? But it actually does. So how, let's give some examples, okay? So writing is structured in that there are spelling rules. We have basic forms that we have to use in order to communicate well. And we take these for granted, right? We understand that there is a certain way to spell certain words. All words have a way to spell them, and you're supposed to use the right one. That's like using the right number when you're doing a calculation in math. Vacuum, neighbor, I'd get into those as a word geek if we'd started at the right time, but I'll never get through the deck if I geek out on every word I put up here. So, point being, there are rules like spelling rules. There are other rules that are even more ingrained that we don't think about. So you might be familiar with the IAO rule, or you probably are not familiar with it, but you use it all the time without knowing. And that rule is basically, if you have two words together, like you're seeing here, two or even three words, the vowel in them will always go in this order. If there is an I word, it will go before an A word or an O word. If there is an A word, it will go after I, but before O. And if one of the words in there has an O in it, that will go last. Now, that's for these sorts of phrases, like ding dong. It's not dong ding. If someone says dong ding, you look at them funny, right? You're like, what aren't you getting here? You don't think about the IAO rule. You're not like, oh, that doesn't follow the IAO rule. You're just like, no, it's actually ding dong. Tick tock, not talk, tick, not tack, tick, tick tock. Dilly dally, diddle dally, all of these things, flip flop. It's even hard to say flop flip, flop flip, flop flip. It's not an easy thing to say. This is a rule that's baked in. There are structures and rules baked in. There's this one too. The Little Red Riding Hood rule. Okay, so this is, you will know this, your brain knows this, and so when things are out of this order, your brain identifies them as wrong, but you might not always know why, so you start shuffling adjectives around until it starts to make sense. And you're generally going to shuffle them into this order. You have the noun. Again, word geeks are gonna have a good time with this. If you're not a word geek, don't worry, the CRO is about to start. But you've got your noun, the thing that you're actually trying to qualify. And then you have all the adjectives that come before it. So they would go in this order. Your opinion on that noun, like pretty. The size of it, the age of it, the shape of it, the color of it, where it's from, what it's made of, and what it's meant to do. That's the order it goes in. So little is size, red is color, riding is purpose, hood is the noun, right? So that is the order that things go in. They just do. If you said Little Riding Red Hood, people would be like, what? What? Like, it's wrong, right? It doesn't feel right. Even if you didn't know what that was, when you hear things out of order, when you're writing and you're like, that sounds clunky, what's wrong with that, the way I've written that? It's usually because there's rules like this that are, again, really baked into how we think and how we write. And you're breaking those rules because you're not aware of those rules. So if we wanted to describe this pool, we might describe it size, color, purpose, noun. Olympic size, or not color, sorry, shape, rectangular, purpose is swimming, pool is the noun. Let's say we wanted to describe this fellow because we're here to edify, to be educated. How would we? How would we do that? We might call him, you know, color, origin, noun, right? This is just for, like, again, edification purposes. This is not a political thing, although I'm super lefty and Canadian. And Justin Trudeau was on the cover of Rolling Stone magazine today. In case you didn't see that, it is trending on Twitter. At least it is for Canadians. And I think the headline is, why can't he be our president? Which I don't think is going to go over very well with old Cheetos-colored Russian-made president. Okay, so those rules are as baked in as math calculations are, right? Except we don't treat them that way. We know that math gets increasingly complicated. And when you want to do different things with math, you have to learn different ways to use math. You have to go beyond the basics. You understand that there are basics, though. For writing, we often forget that, right? And we don't act like there are new rules to layer on top of the rules we already know. If we want to do different things, we have to add new rules in. So just like an engineer adds new rules to 1 + 2 = 3 in order to build a bridge, we as marketers need to add new rules to the writing rules that we already know. Everything you know is just the foundation. Now we need to build on top of that. And some of the new rules you're going to learn will challenge the earlier rules. It won't challenge spelling rules or the IAO rule, but maybe some of the things that we think are rules, like I have to go off and be quiet and it's me against the page. It doesn't have to be that way. We're gonna talk through some rules for that. So here is your crash course in conversion copywriting. We're gonna talk about three key things. And if you are familiar with the Copy Hackers, with what we teach at Copy Hackers, you are likely to already, hopefully, God, I hope so at least, be familiar with these. We do talk about them quite a bit because they are at the core of conversion copywriting. And if you are not familiar with Copy Hackers or conversion copywriting, then this will be that crash course that you need to stop beating your head against the wall every time it's time to write that sales email or whatever it might be. Okay, so we're gonna start with the first one, which is always write from the appropriate stage of awareness. So you may or may not know what stages of awareness are. We're gonna get into that right away. If you do, feel free to chat those stages out. I won't see them, but you'll feel pretty good geeking out about it. So feel free to do that. We're gonna want to write from the right stage of awareness. Now, once we'll get into those, but why? Like, what? So I can tell you this stuff, but if you don't know why you're gonna do anything, you're unlikely to do it. So, okay. So let's say it's time for you to write a landing page. Let's say you're Wistia and you want to write a landing page for a keyword phrase, video hosting. You might begin with, well, what should my headline be? Like, that's one of the first things you'll actually think when it comes time for you to sit down and write that landing page. It's for video hosting. What should my headline be? Okay, so I did a quick Google search on this, video hosting, and I grabbed some screenshots of the landing pages for you. So if I search video hosting, we can see that there are three paid ads here. The Vimeo one, the Wistia one, and this video hosting service by Brightcove one. Okay, so we've got those three. I've taken screenshots of them. Those are all pages that they are serving up that they'll have to pay me to land on, like, not pay me, pay Google in order to get me to land on them, right? Real money attached to the performance of these pages. Okay, for video hosting, great. So here are the pages that we see. Here are the really the hero sections for them where we can look at the headlines. High quality, affordable video hosting is what Vimeo said. Okay, Wistia. I'm gonna wait for it to catch up. Hopefully it does. There we go. Hopefully everything's keeping up okay for you. Video hosting with a creative twist. And the next one by Bright Cove is Test Drive Enterprise Video Suite. Okay, so we had those three PPC landing page hero sections. Now, again, we know the keyword phrase that we're going to be writing for is video hosting. So if we had to write those pages, what do we really know about someone searching video hosting? How do we know what to put in the headline? And then from there, what to put on the page? This is the question you have to answer as soon as you sit down to write any copy. Where do I start? What's in the middle, and where am I taking them to? And that all depends not on what you want to say, it's on what they need to hear. So what do we know about someone searching video hosting? What do we absolutely know? If we're writing for Wistia, let's say again, this landing page, do they know about Wistia? Do we know if they know? Are they using YouTube? Are they creating videos already? Are they trying to grow their business? Are they collecting leads? Are they curious about video hosting? Do they want a free trial of a video hosting solution? Are they ready for that free trial? Are they on a team creating videos? What do we know? Now, I can't see you. I can't see your chats, but I'm hoping that the one thing we know, the only thing we know, and even this has some gray area around it, is that they're interested in video hosting. Now, interested is a loaded word. But it's like, for lack of a better word, they're curious about video hosting. There is something that has them curious about video hosting. We don't know if it's for their own videos. We don't know if they're just trying to define a term because they were in a meeting that somebody had where someone said video hosting. And they're like, I don't know what video hosting is. And they went and Googled it quickly. We don't know any of those things. All we know is that there is a level of interest in video hosting. Okay. Knowing that is true and that we don't know if they know about Wistia, we don't know if they're considering YouTube or creating videos or using videos for their business or using videos for their wedding site, or they want a free trial of something that will do this. We don't know anything but video hosting. So that's not a great place to be in if you want to write an entire page, especially as Andy said in his last awesome talk, no shorties, right? Now, that doesn't mean there are no cases in which we're going to get into that exact thing, but chances are good you're not only going to put a headline and a button, unless you're Google's home screen, you're not going to put a headline and a button on a page and call it a day. You'll probably get some pretty good curiosity clicks, I'll say that. But outside of that, will it actually convert well? We have to fill whole pages that try to convince people to take action, using nothing more than knowing this, at least as a starting point, that they're interested in video hosting. So what do? That's where stages of awareness is so critical. Now I'm gonna walk you through those stages of awareness. There are five of them. I'm not gonna go too slowly because I'm aware that you have a different tab. And if you're really super curious, you can always like over to Copy Hackers and just like find any of our posts on stages of awareness. But I recommend that you stay here for now. And if you wanna learn more, then go learn more afterward. Okay, so here are the five stages of awareness. Unaware, a prospect doesn't know if they have any pain. They don't know anything. They might know your brand. They might have seen your commercials online. They might know that you're Apple and you make MacBooks, but they don't yet have a pain. They haven't in any way associated your solution with themselves. Okay, so that's unaware. Pain aware, they're starting to feel a pain. Okay, there's a pain, there's a twinge, there's something in there. Solution aware, they've started looking at ways to solve their pain. They know that solutions exist. Product aware is they know that solutions exist, and here are some of the types of them. So actual products that can solve their problems. And most aware is that higher level, the level that we're really looking to get people to in order to get them to convert. They know products exist, they know your product is one of them, and they're at a point where they could believe that your product may or may not, sadly sometimes it will be, may not be right for them, but they are at that most aware stage. Okay, so if we go back to the video hosting keyword phrase, okay, how could we plot that on this exact spectrum that we're seeing here? And I just want to do as a little quick caveat that these are not silos, it's a spectrum. So you'll move maybe slowly through unaware, quickly into pain or solution, and then slowly through product and most. It depends. Point being, this is the order that it goes, and then we can't skip people through these parts. We have to move them through each stage of awareness, like the stages of grief, almost, right? Sadly, that's a really sad comparison, but you have to move through them in order to get to the end. Okay, so if we were to plot video hosting on there, or any of the questions that we have about this person who's coming to the page, let's say if they were to search the keyword phrase YouTube sucks, then we would know that they're pain aware. If they're going to search video hosting, then we know that they are solution aware. They're aware of a solution. This isn't a pain keyword phrase. It's also not a branded keyword phrase. If they're Wistia, they're probably product aware. Okay, they're at least product aware. They might be most aware, we don't know, but we know they're at least product aware. They're aware of Wistia. We have cause to believe, an assumption to make there, that they're not searching Wistia because someone said Wistia and they're so super bored, they're like, what's Wistia? And it has nothing to do with any pain that they may have. Although that can sometimes be true, and that is the marketer's challenge. Nonetheless, if they search that branded keyword phrase, chances are good they're product aware or getting there on the spectrum. If they search Wistia discount, they're very likely most aware. They're at a place where they've felt their pain, they've looked at solutions, they've identified Wistia as a product that can solve their pain. Now they're like, okay, but what does it cost? And can I get it for less than other people are paying for it? So that's the general way that we would move people through, or that we can expect to kind of plot where people are on that stages of awareness spectrum, knowing that this is, again, this is a presentation. There are greater examples to dig under here. Okay, so our goal here is to connect stages of awareness in this crash course in conversion copywriting, to connect the stage of awareness with that headline as a starting point. So we want to join our reader in their starting stage of awareness, and that's going to shape your headline. Then on the page, we're going to move them to the next stage, and that is all. Here's what that looks like. If your reader joins the conversation, which is what we say in copywriting, or arrives on your page is another way to look at it, or lands on your ad, or opens your email in this stage of awareness, problem aware, your job as a conversion copywriter, as somebody who's invested in growth, is not just to throw them in and say, hey, you're problem aware, here are all the problems, here are all the solutions, here are the products to solve them, here's our product, but here's what's so great about it, here's a discount for it. That's not it. Your job is to move them to the next stage of awareness, solution aware. This is what funnels do. This is when you hear about funnels and you're like, okay, but what do I do in my funnel? This is how you shape your funnel. Your headline matches that starting stage of awareness. By the end of the page, your offer matches or sets up that next stage of awareness. This is a breakthrough kind of thing if you actually write copy for a living, where you measure what it's doing, what it's not doing. Problem moves to solution. Solution moves to product. Okay, so your headline will then match. If they join the page solution aware, they're looking for video hosting. So they search video hosting, your headline will include the phrase video hosting. Your job on that page is move them from thinking about video hosting to understanding that Wistia is a great solution for video hosting. That's getting them to product aware. Your offer then is around that new level of product awareness. Okay, pretty straightforward, pretty clean. Hopefully a useful way for you to look at it. If you don't think it's useful now, try it. This is exactly the kind of stuff that changes the performance of your copy, because it eliminates that guesswork. It eliminates sitting down, staring ahead, and going, I think my reader cares about, I don't know, getting a free trial of our solution. When, like, sure, people like free trials, only when they're ready for the free trial though, right? So we have to start with their opening stage of awareness and then move them to the next one, okay? So that means you cannot lead with your product. You cannot say Wistia if your reader is unaware, problem aware, or only solution aware when they arrive on that page or when they open that email. It's too soon. It won't perform well enough, okay? It also holds that you cannot ask for a purchase or a trial until your reader is at least product aware. So that means that those people, and I had a terrible boss. At some point, people are going to identify who this poor fellow was. Poor guy. I don't actually think that in any way. But he insisted that every headline should have a discount in it. Just say what the discount is. And of course, almost every marketer on the planet like rallies hard against that idea. But some people do think, okay, and I can appreciate why they do. Not a great idea, but you can appreciate why you would think, well, if you have a discount to offer at some point, why don't you just offer that discount to everybody? If you have a free trial, just get them into the free trial. But anybody who is actually trying to nurture people from free to paid customers or to get good customers in who aren't just going to ask for a refund, who are actually going to be really happy users of the product, know that you cannot actually present an offer to buy until your reader has been moved through the whole spectrum of understanding that they have a pain, that solutions exist for that pain, that yours is a great solution for that, and that they should then move forward and choose you, okay? This rule also holds that if you need to move a prospect through multiple stages of awareness, you need longer copy and or a nurturing sequence, okay? So that stages of awareness spectrum that we have is how you really build a funnel. That's how you move people through your funnel. Depending where they join that funnel, whatever stage of awareness that is in, then you know what pages you have to move them to. You know what emails you have to push them through in order to get them to a place where they're actually at that final stage of most aware, which is where the conversions happen most easily. When they're most aware, when they're most aware with high intent, good things happen. Okay, so now let's look at these home pages. Once again, these headlines that we had. So there was the Bright Cove one. Video hosting was the keyword phrase. Test drive enterprise video suite. Plans start at $199 a month. Try it free for 30 days. Video hosting is solution aware. Why are they leading with the price or incentive? If you are, this is a great way to go in and start changing things up right now. Start running tests where if you're landing people who are solution or pain aware on a landing page that's actually trying to sell them right out of the gate, right at the top of the page, this is a great place for you to optimize. Now, Wistia has video hosting with a creative twist. Their call to action here is to start a free trial, which could be problematic if not for the video. So the video here nurtures people from that solution awareness, video hosting, through to product awareness, as in why you should choose Wistia. Might they perform better not having this call to action over to the side here, which could be a big distraction and keep people from actually playing the video? Maybe that's something worth testing, right? When should that offer appear? I wouldn't make it appear right there at that point. They do, worth testing for you, right? You wanna make sure that by the time your prospect sees the offer, sees that call to action, they're ready for it because you've moved them from unaware to pain aware, solution aware, product aware, most aware. Cool? Okay, so again, this is the spectrum. I'm aware that the internet is maybe not keeping up as well. Hopefully there are no weird garbly noises with audio. I know that happened a bit in the last session, and I think it had to do with Chrome. So hopefully if you're on Chrome, everything's working out well for you and everything is keeping up for speed. Okay, so quick example of how we use this exact spectrum to help Wistia with some emails. So again, I mentioned that this is what you do to move people, like you followed this sequence, this spectrum, in order to move people through the stages of awareness to get them to convert. Okay, so we worked on a sequence for Wistia, and I'm gonna finally write a big post about this. This happened last year, but so what, still super relevant. I'm gonna finally write a post on this, so watch for that on Copy Hackers coming up soon. But we rewrote 8 emails for Wistia in their email trial, like their trial sequence, their emails for their trial sequence. These are the ones that we wrote. We had the first 3 were under product aware. So you joined the sequence and you joined in a product aware stage. We knew they were product aware by the time they got into the sequence. They'd already gone through the initial nurturing part of the trial, and now they're at a place where they were very product aware, and we just had to move them through product awareness, which meant walking them through different features and showing the real value of those features to, again, help really nurture and dig that message in. Then most aware, we had a couple emails there as well for most aware. which are loading slowly. So when they're most aware, we got into sales emails. These are long form sales emails. They didn't happen for the product aware part of it. They're happening at the most aware stage. Once we know someone's gone through those other three emails, they're now definitely product aware. We're moving them towards most aware, and we're moving them even further. If they don't convert in that most aware moment, then we move them to most aware with high intent, where we really try to like amplify their intent and build it up. And that was, in this case, by repositioning an existing offer to sound like it was a special incentive at that time. Those are the three stages that we followed. And again, most aware with high intent is like the secret bonus stage for those who haven't converted during most aware. What can you do to really lay it on thick to get that most aware with high intent, to get that intent up? With that, we brought in 3 times the paid conversions. That was just by rewriting and reorganizing those emails so that we moved people through that sequence. Now, I'm very conscious that I am taking a lot of time to talk about this, and I only got a few minutes left. So quickly into the next one. Rule number 2, never start from scratch. Never, ever start from scratch. Never sit there, stare at the screen, and wait for your fingers to start magically moving over the keyboard. It's crazy. What we want to do is what we see other people already doing. You might recognize some of it when it comes up. Hopefully it's coming up. There we go. I hope that you're seeing that now. Okay. Really old. I mean, they're 50 plus whatever years old, not even in some cases. Ads that performed really well. Okay, so what can we do with that? This is what copywriters call a swipe file. You keep high performing ads, or ads that you believe strongly in. And when I say ads, I today mean also landing pages, emails, actual ads, Facebook ads, all those kinds of things. You keep them in a swipe file. And then when it's time for you to write, you refer to them and you see what you can use from what they were doing to write your own stuff. So we see this happening all over the place. BuzzFeed became a $1 billion company by taking the headline writing rules that we saw way back when and just applying them again, right? And I'm going to talk you through what some of those are. For example, this Indigenous teen's reaction to her grad gift will make you feel things. It's the third one down here, if you can see it. Hopefully you can. If you can't, there, I just read it to you. What's happening there? And it is exactly the same thing that's been happening in high performing copy throughout history. Okay, so what can we do with that? Cool. All right. Here's an example of one of those emails that I was telling you about. So we saw 18% more people click play when we did this. Joanna, first name, whatever, I just happened. My first name is Joanna. This is the email that I wrote and my first name is put in there. Okay, so we saw 18% more people click play when we did this, Joanna. That is a headline formula swiped from old school stuff. Now you can see that the actual content of that headline, we saw 18% more people click play when we did this, Joanna. The core of the content can't be swiped. 18% more people, this is a social proof thing, okay, click play. That's an action that didn't happen 50 years ago when we did this. So what we are really doing is taking the foundation of great headlines throughout history, and some of them come off as clickbaity, and that, again, depends on the content you put in them. This is going for curiosity, like opening the curiosity gap. So the question that you ask as a reader when you see this is, we saw 18% more people click play when we did this, Joanna. You ask, did what, right? So this, with a space after it, creates what's called a curiosity gap. So if we said what this was when we changed the player color, if we had said that, there'd be no reason to keep reading. There'd be nothing to draw you deeper in. A pretty simple rule for this is, if you're giving away the answer, just cut out the answer and replace it with this. Don't put a noun after this. It's really straightforward editing that you go in and do. If you're telling the whole story, what can you do to pull out the whole story so people have to keep reading? Do you need and want to keep reading, or is the story already told in your headline? If the story is already told, scrap the part that tells the story, period. Or scrap the whole headline and start again. We have this idea that if you don't tell everything in a headline, you're not being clear. And the user experience team is like, why don't you just say what it is? You are in conversion rate optimization. Part of that is getting people to stop scrolling and stop clicking away and actually read through line by line. So I'm just like, just shooting all over the place and looking at whatever they feel like and letting their scroll go anywhere they feel like. You want to control that scroll. That's the job that you have to do. And by not telling the whole story, you do that. You know that they're going to want to read the next line. And you know that you're going to want to keep reading them, keep them reading line after line after line. Another thing to do, again, when we're not starting from scratch here, we're going to have those swipe files that you're going to start keeping. Also start with formulas. A really, really good one. My favorite one. I know there are some people from my mastermind on this call right now. They'll know this. Others will know this as well because I talk about it all the time. Problem, agitation, solution. Works in any stage of awareness, not just in problem stage, in case you're like, wait, this is only going to work for problem. Not that you are thinking that, but if you are, don't worry. It works in every single stage of awareness. The idea here is that you set up the problem that your prospect is feeling. You agitate it so they actually feel it, and then you solve it. So we did this with sweat block as a really clean example. This is a page that we wrote that we tested with sweat block at sweatblock.com. This was their homepage. We tested it against a different page, which I'll show you right away, their control homepage. But let's zero in on the top of it. It's a long page. Let's zero in. We have the problem, agitation. So we had the problem set up as, it doesn't even have to be hot out. My armpits are always wet. In quotation marks, that's a real problem people were really feeling, and I'll tell you how we got there in the next tip. The next tip, it's like the next major segment. And then agitation. We got into the details, like make them feel it, agitate it. So deodorant isn't enough. You've tried to hide all your sweating by never wearing light blue or light gray. Black is best. Wearing a quote unquote sweat soaker undershirt. Tucking tissues inside your shirt and trying not to move much. Avoiding situations that could trigger nervous sweating. Wearing sleeveless, colorless tops in the summer and dabbing frequently. Avoiding high-fiving, avoiding pointing, hugging carefully. Like, this was a real agitation list that kept going on. Then we agitated it further in a testimonial that followed, and only once we had switched from the agitation part of the testimonial to sweat block is a solution, that is where we start to see what the solution is. We have lured our prospect in by zeroing in on their problem and dimensionalizing it, really agitating it. So we finally see at the end the product. We had the control version, had the product as the hero. Our version had the pain, had the prospect feeling pain as the hero. Now that meant, of course, as you saw, really delaying the product reveal. And I promise you, if you feel uncomfortable about that, every online business feels uncomfortable about that. And that is why we test, which is, again, exactly what we did here for Sweatblock. We tested our version against their control where their product was the hero. And as soon as this catches up, gifts are hard with an internet connection. One sec. I don't know if it's there already for you. Okay, good. Once we tested that, our new version, you saw the whole one, I'm just showing you the top of it again, 49% more paid conversions. It pays off to follow frameworks. If you are writing a page and you don't know why you're putting things in that order, stop doing it. Go find a framework. Copy Hackers has a huge list, ultimate list of headline formulas on there. It's our number one post over the last 6 years. So go on there, grab that, and always start with a framework. Finally, I know we've got like 40 seconds left. Always be swiping. And this one actually is really fast, but it's absolutely critical. So I want to like not rush too much through it. Hopefully the next speaker doesn't get super mad at me for it. But here, let's take a look at this. Now you might recognize this song. Begins, what do you do with the mad that you feel when you feel so mad you could bite? Do you know it? This is a song that Mr. Rogers sang, actually. And what's interesting about it, Mr. Rogers, amazing dude, if you've ever learned anything about him, pretty amazing. His mom actually made all of his sweaters, which is either really cool or really weird, I don't know. But he got this line, what do you do with the mad that you feel? A child said that to him, a child asked him that, and then he turned it into a song, and he took those specifics from real life experiences he had with the people he was trying to talk to. He was trying to talk to kids, he was trying to listen to them, and then share that back with them so they could better understand what to do next. Others were talking down to kids, parents talked down to kids, aunts and uncles, I know from experience, talked down to kids, but Mr. Rogers talked to kids using their own words. He didn't talk, he listened, right? And that's our job. It's not to talk, It's to listen. And then we take what we hear and we simply push it back at our prospect. It's really simple, it's really straightforward, and it's at the core of empathy, which is at the core of great conversion copywriting. How do we do that? Sometimes you can go out and you can interview people. There are lots of different ways to do it. We talk about it all the time. Talia talks about it as well. I strongly recommend message mining as a really quick way in to conversations, especially if you want to write copy and the deadline's due, like the deadline's like this afternoon, and you have a boss like me who gets crazy when someone misses the deadline. Like, I don't understand how you can miss a deadline. So if that's the case and you have a deadline you have to hit for your crazy boss, and maybe you're your own crazy boss, cool. Then how do we do that? We go message mining. We go look at forums, at review sites, again, Amazon is my favorite one. I'm going to show you how that works. But you go look at where people are talking naturally about how they feel about your product, about their pain, about solutions that are out there, about their expectations. And you simply take what they're saying and you use it in your copy. That's exactly what we did to create this headline and a lot of the content within this email, which is one of those emails that brought in more than 300% lift in paid conversions. What's red and unsupported and stuck in the middle of a horde of out of control, sometimes crass strangers. All of that is lifted from what people were saying about YouTube. Just pulled. I didn't have to make it up, and then we didn't have to say something as boring as like, hey, YouTube is lacking support. You should use Wistia. Instead, we were actually going in and taking real language that people were using and turning that into powerful copy. Now, here is how you mine for your message very quickly, okay? On one or more sites with reviews, find products or services in your category. So that might sometimes mean books that are like kind of in your category that someone hires to do the job that your product is there to do or your service is there to do. Whatever the case, you want to go and you want to look for mass quantities of reviews that are unfiltered and ideally unbiased, knowing that they're not always going to be perfect. You can't always get everything perfect. This is a close proxy for actually interviewing your customers and talking to them. Okay, go through the reviews and clip the most memorable insights, and that is the stuff that sticks, the stuff that makes you pause. Examples, real specifics. We'll talk about their expectations, their challenges, their wishes, their hopes, what was missing in a product that they thought was going to do a certain job, what was extra that delighted them that they hadn't even expected. You clip all of that stuff, you take all of that stuff, and then you take your framework we talked about earlier, again, that's a formula or a framework like problem education solution, and you just start organizing those new messages within each part of your framework. Okay, I know that this isn't catching up, and I'm also very conscious of the time. Hopefully everybody is still there because I haven't heard anything and I can't see anything. Okay, but this is organizing all of that in your framework. That's it. Go listen, take exactly what you hear, and then start organizing it in your framework. That is how you get draft one. Then your job becomes stitching all of that together. When you script your videos, when you write sales pages, you do not want to look inside your head for your copy, guys. That is not where your high converting messages are living. And even if you have a genius high converting message in there, do you know the right stage of awareness and if it's going to be right for your prospect? Are you putting it in the right order in a framework? We want to begin with the stage of awareness, start writing with a framework, and instead of actually writing, simply swipe. Just listen and repeat back what you hear in the order your prospect needs to hear it to be convinced. That is all. I don't think we have time for questions, but I don't know. Maybe we do. So follow me at Copy Hacker.
Wow. I'm like,
Talia.
Did you breathe, you poor thing? You were like, I have to get through everything.
I know, right? Yeah. Well, we started late.
Yes.
Crowdcast. Damn you, crowdcast. Okay, good. So do we have any questions or is there any time? I assume there's no time.
Unfortunately, Claire is waiting in the other session.
Claire.
Sorry.
Claire.
But everyone does have some great questions for you. So what I'm going to do, we're going to be sending out like a blog post with just kind of the best, the most important stuff out of each presentation. And I'll also send you the questions so you can maybe answer them. And we'll put that in the blog post along with a bit of the recordings of whatever's available. And that way everyone will get their questions answered.
Cool. Okay. That sounds amazing to me. So thank you. And you're going to love Claire. She's amazing. Thanks everybody. And thanks Talia.
Thank you so much. It was great listening to you as usual. Guys, I'm just going to move everyone to the next room. So see you there.